And good morning to you. Greetings from Portland, Oregon. It is 9 o'clock here on the West Coast as we launch day two of the Ambassadors Forum Fall Apologetics Conference. I hope you were with us last night. It was a jam-packed evening. And today, if you thought last night was good, today is going to be incredible. All three of our plenary speakers are back, plus three breakout sessions. And we end today with a live Q&A. It's going to be incredible. More on that with the Q&A in just a moment. I want to tell you how you can be part of that. I want to thank Summit Ministries again for being a major part of this year's conference and bringing it to you virtually, again, not just here on the West Coast, but across the nation and internationally as well. As we move through day two, we want to remind you about two options on the conference page, the Ask a Question and the Technical Support option. So if you've got issues today with the live stream, or if you want a question about breakouts or whatever, you want to click on that Technical Support button. If, however, you're watching and you see a speaker and you have a question you want to pose to one of them, Josh or Alec or Roy, later today in the live Q&A, you're going to want to click on Ask a Question because we're going to be collating those questions and then bringing them to you live in the Q&A later this afternoon. We're not going to mention names or locations, so just ask a question freely. We encourage you again to head to the conference page for that. I also want to mention to all the students out there, the juniors, the seniors, the forward-thinking college students, you've got two more opportunities to take part in that virtual campus visit. The nine universities across seven different states, all participating via Zoom. These Christian college representatives are in the Zooms, would love to talk to you. Again, here are the nine universities and your options. There's two left. Between 11 and noon and 1:30 and 2:30. Visit as many as you can, get the code words, then put them into the contest form. You could win later today, $25, $50, or $100, okay? Campus visits at the bottom. One more thing, just a couple more quick shout-outs. Thanks for the selfies. Goodness, you've been really creative. Here's Zach in Portland checking in, looking happy there. It looks like maybe even some dinner over the Apologetics Conference. John Wilson checking in, Gina Albright as well. Here's the family of Michael, Nicole, Kira, Audrey, and Ryan. A dog and a bearded dragon is what I'm being told. We've got Gavin checking in. Joanna is in Colorado. And all the way from Qatar. This is incredible. I don't know how many hours away they are, but here's Renisha and Charles checking in, watching live here on the West Coast from Qatar. So incredible. So while we'd love to be together with you here in this building, the great thing about virtual is we can reach not just here on the West Coast, but really across the world. So here we go. Buckle up, gear up. It's day two. Roy takes the stage right after we pick up this text conversation with Allison and Sydney. Thank you.
I want to start by introducing my family to you this morning. My wife and I have 7 kids, and we used to homeschool all of them. Now, when I usually tell people that, they think our family picture should look something like this. That's what all large homeschool families look like, right? We make our own clothes, we churn our own butter. Actually, this is the reality. We took this picture at an escape room building on Father's Day. We had a blast. As you can tell, we call this our Charlie's Angels pose. Now, the reason I wanted to show you a picture of my family is because I wanted to tell you the story of how we started homeschooling. We had just moved to a property way out in the woods, 30 minutes from anything, and my wife was driving into town every day for 3 different school schedules, preschool, kindergarten, and elementary school. We had a Suburban that got like 6 miles to the gallon, and so she was filling up the gas tank like 3 times a week. After several months of this, I sat down with my wife and I said, "Honey, why don't you just stay home with the kids?" She had a degree in early childhood education, so we thought she could just teach the kids herself. I told her, "You'll probably spend less time teaching than you do driving." We hadn't really heard of the term homeschooling yet, so I just said, "We'll call it school at home." I was working at Intel at the time as a research engineer, and they had this awesome program where every seven years of employment, you got to take an additional 8 weeks off. So on my first sabbatical in the summer, we sat down and we figured out what the Swart House school at home was going to look like, and we got started. Now later, we discovered that there was this whole homeschool movement out there, like it was actually a real thing. So we got our official large family homeschooling ID cards, started making our own clothes and churning our own butter, and we were off and running, or something like that. Now, what happened next was nothing short of unbelievable. As I started to synthesize all of this knowledge that I needed to pass down to my own kids, I realized that my own thinking was all tangled up and contradictory. I didn't know what to call it at the time, but since then I've realized it was my worldview. Now, in my own education as a kid, I had been trained to think illogically and to make false and arbitrary assumptions and presuppositions, to manipulate the facts to fit what I can now call a secular humanist worldview. So I spent those first 5 years of homeschooling unlearning all of those falsehoods and contradictory systems that I had learned as foundations early in my education. And then I had to relearn the basics, to relay the foundation of what I would call a biblical worldview. Now, that whole experience, that whole journey, is the background and context of this talk today, and I am so excited to share it with you. I believe there is no more important thing, no more important subject than how we think. Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, "Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." Now, did you catch that? Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. You might say, a new person? Yeah. That's what becoming a Christian is all about. It's not about going to church. It's not about learning to sing in the choir or even about starting to read the Bible. You may end up doing those things, and those are good things, and you should do them. They're great, but that's not what makes you a Christian. When you get saved, you become a new person. It's like this. Hi, I'm Roy Swart. You may think you met me before, but that wasn't me. That was the old Roy Swart. Yeah, he looked like me, and he talked like me. Maybe he had an awesome beard like me, but that wasn't me. Nice to meet you. I'm the new Roy Swart. That's what the Bible talks about when it says we are made a new creation in Christ. And the new person has so much work to do. When Paul says, don't copy the customs of this world, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, he's talking about the wrong way of thinking. You need to start thinking in a new way. You need to start thinking biblically. So, how does all this work? Well, everybody today is looking for the truth. It is the number one thing on everybody's mind. But nobody understands what it is, or how to get it, or even how to recognize once they've got it. Now, the basic outline of this talk is going to be very simple. I'm just going to teach you one thing on one slide. And then I'm going to take the rest of the time and I'm going to illustrate that concept with examples again and again and again to try and make it make sense. Because it's a big idea. And it's because many of you, just like me, had years, decades of wrong thinking. And you have to undo that in your mind. Okay, you guys ready? Here goes. There's only one way to know truth. There's only one way to know truth. Sorry. Okay, here goes. There's only two ways to know truth. A little bit of a technical glitch there. There's only two ways to get truth. Number one, you learn it from someone else. Number two, you experience it for yourself. That's it. Think about it. When you learn it from someone else, let's call that revelation. Some people might want to call it academia, like in an academy or a school, because someone else is teaching you, literally. Now, the second one, when you personally see it, hear it, touch it, experience it, let's call that observation. Now, some people might want to call this the school of hard knocks, because they would say something like, I won't believe it until I see it myself. I think our friend Alec McClellan said that's probably describes the Scots pretty well. Those are the only two possibilities. So, there you go. That's the whole lesson. Now, let me give you the first example of how this works. I'm going to ask you a question. You ready? What is the capital of Scotland? Okay, I'll give you a hint. Look at this picture. Now, to somebody like Alec McClellan, he knows what this picture is. He's been there, and so have I. It's Edinburgh, just like they say it in Scotland, or Edinburgh, like we would pronounce it here in the U.S. Alec and I know where the castle is. We know where the parliament is. We've both been to St. Margaret's Chapel, and we've walked along those walls here in this picture and stared out over the city towards the North Sea of the Atlantic Ocean. Even now, we can close our eyes and still see it. It's beautiful. Alec and I have firsthand knowledge of the fact that Edinburgh is the capital of Scotland. Now, how about you? How did you know the answer to that question? I would venture to say that since this is probably mostly an American audience, that most of you haven't been to Edinburgh. So you had to have somebody tell you that truth. It may have been in person, it may have been through a book, it may have been through a video on the internet. So Alec and I, and I'm sure there was many others as well, we knew that truth by direct observation. The rest of you had to learn it by revelation. See how this works? Now, I'd like to introduce you to two other words to help further develop this idea: deductive and inductive. Now, I'm sure many of you have heard these words before, so let's start with deductive. As a way to get truth, deductive reasoning follows a pretty simple process. It starts with an assumption, an initial truth. This is what we just defined as revelation, something we learn from someone else. Now, it follows with a correct observation. Now, why do I say the word correct? Because a lot of the time we think we see things, we don't. Or we view them incorrectly. Or we don't pay close enough attention to the details. Now, you don't believe me? Let's try a little test. Go ahead and stare at this screen for a while. Make sure you take it all in. Okay, now I'm going to switch screens. Pay very close attention. Take your time. Now for the test. Did the number of puppies increase or decrease? And did the number of kittens increase or decrease? Sometimes it can be pretty hard to make a correct observation. It can be harder to make a correct observation than you think, right? So for those of you who are wondering what the correct answer is, I'll tell you. I have one daughter who's a dog lover, and she's sitting here in person. Hello. And I have one daughter who's a cat lover. She's tuning in from Colorado. Hey. So I had both of them increase because you can never have too many cute puppies and kittens. Next, it follows inherent logic. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean what you knew to be true when you were in the third grade. My youngest daughter is in the third grade now, so I tried this out on her. I said to her, "Hello, sweetie, I'm a tree and a person." And she immediately shot back with, "You can't be both." So then I said to her, "Well, then I'm a tree." At this point, she just rolled her eyes and said, "No, Abba, you're a person." That's what I mean by inherent logic. And the process ends with an addition, by reaching an additional truth. Now, let's walk through an example of what deductive reasoning looks like in real life. All people are created in the image of God. This is the first step. We called it a revelation, an initial truth that was told to us by someone else. Now, in this example, this truth was communicated by the person at the top of the picture on the right, who's God, for those of you who don't recognize this from the Sistine Chapel painting. Now, number two, Socrates is a person. That's an observation. It's a correct observation. And the third step is to apply our inherent logic to arrive at a conclusion. Help me out here, folks. Right. Socrates is created in the image of God, which is our additional truth. Now, you might be asking, well, does deductive reasoning always produce an additional truth? Let's think it through. If you start with an assumption that is really true, and you make a correct observation, and you use consistent logic, then absolutely, your conclusion will be right. And ding, 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 you will reach an additional truth. But what if your starting assumption is false, and your observation is incorrect? and your logic is inconsistent, then your conclusion will obviously be wrong, and you won't reach any new truth. In fact, all you have is what I call useless drivel. Now, what about a hybrid approach? What if some of the steps are correct and some of the steps are incorrect? Let's say you start with an assumption that is really true, and you make a correct observation, but in the end, your logic is inconsistent. Then your conclusion will still be wrong, and all you have is useless drivel. If you start with an assumption that is really true, but then you make an observation that is incorrect, but then you go back and you use consistent logic, your conclusion will be wrong, and again, useless drivel. And just to finish it up here, let's say your starting assumption is false, but then you make a correct observation, and you use consistent logic, you guessed it, wrong conclusion, useless drivel. You can see there are so many ways to end up with a wrong conclusion and useless drivel. But there's only one way to reach a right conclusion and additional truth. Now that you're all experts on deductive reasoning, let's move on deductive reasoning. Let's move on to cover inductive reasoning as a way to get to truth. It starts with a correct observation. It follows with additional correct observations. And it follows with that same third grade inherent logic. Let's walk through an example to illustrate this concept. We'll start with our same population of folks from last time. Socrates is a person. He died. That's an observation. Happens to be a correct observation. Plato is a person. He died. That's another correct observation. Aristotle is a person. He died. That's another correct observation in our second step of additional correct observations. The third step is to apply our inherent third grade logic again and reach the conclusion of, help me out here again, all people will die. So what's the process of inductive reasoning end in? Well, before we answer that, let's go back and make another observation. Elijah is a person. He did not die. That's an observation. And it's a correct observation. So if we go back, our conclusion that all people will die turns out to be false. And it becomes evident that our inductive process can either end in the conclusion that is right or wrong. Even if we followed all the steps correctly, this is so important to understand. It's not like the examples we reviewed with the deductive process, where we showed that we came to a wrong conclusion only if we didn't follow the process. This shows that the process itself is prone to failure in identifying the truth. And it's very important to recognize that it only takes one contradictory, correct observation to make our conclusion wrong. What we found is a falsehood. So let's call it a not truth. Well, you say, at least the process can sometimes end in a right conclusion, correct? Well, not so fast. Let's think about it. The inductive reasoning process is like a strongman test at the carnival, where you try to hit the plank and make the ball go all the way to the top. At the bottom is totally false. At the very top is totally true. Confidence goes up as consistent data goes up. And remember, it only takes one contradictory observation to destroy your hypothesis. Our confidence begins at the bottom and goes up with consistent observations. Let's say 1 to 100 comes off of the floor. At 100 to 10,000, it goes up a little higher. At 10,000 to a million observations, it goes up even higher. But you can imagine that it will eventually reach a maximum level of confidence. And this can only be described as probable. This is because the certainty of a conclusion from the inductive method will always be limited by our ability to observe. Because we can never observe everything, our confidence will always be limited. Okay, who here likes science? You know that I do. It's what pays the bills for me. Where do you think science fits in? Which of these processes do you think best represents the scientific method? You're right. The inductive method. It has direct observations and testing hypotheses. But wait a minute, I hear some of you saying. You just said that the inductive method can never absolutely prove additional truths. You said all it could do was show if something is wrong, or at the very best, conclude that it was only probable. That sure doesn't sound like the all-powerful resume of science that I've heard. Isn't it supposed to be the last great bastion of truth? Isn't science supposed to be the purveyor of all knowledge? Isn't science supposed to be the only salvation of mankind? Yeah, so let's talk about that. I hate to burst your bubble, but if that's what you've been told about science, you've been lied to. And that's coming from a true blue scientist who makes my living every day doing the scientific method. Now, I need to let you in on a little secret from the scientific community. And I know every scientist out there on the internet just jumped out of their chair, ran to the screen and said, Roy, no, you promised. We can never share the secret. Well, I'm going to, because this is a virtual conference and no one can rush the stage and mob me and shut me down. So here it is. Listen up, pay attention. Science never proves anything. It can't. It's not designed to. The only thing science can do is disprove things. Okay, now I bet some of you are really confused. Time for another example. Think of science like a bulldozer. And think of the truth like houses. The bulldozer goes up to a house and tries to knock it down. If it does, then that house wasn't really a truth. It was a falsehood. It was a not truth. So, we're going to take our bulldozer science. We're going to go up to the first house, and it knocks it down. That obviously was a not truth. Then it goes to the second house and knocks it down too. Another not truth. Then it goes to the third house and again knocks it down. Another not truth. And so it goes on and on and on again, proving things are not true. And finally, it comes to something it can't knock down. Well, that might be a truth. It doesn't know. All it knows is it hasn't knocked it down yet. So do you see how this works? Now, I want to make something very clear. The bulldozer is never building houses. It can't. Do you understand why? Let me test you. Here's in this illustration. Could science ever build the Taj Mahal? No, all it can do is tear things down. All it can do is tear down the houses. Now, I know this is radical stuff, especially if you haven't grown up with a biblical worldview. Let me try again to summarize the case for science. The best it can ever do is to fail to disprove something. That's not the same as proving it. Let me say that again. The bulldozer can only not knock a house down. It can never build the house. Now, I want to go back to our deductive and inductive reasoning table and point out one more thing. You'll notice that to get a truth, you have to start with the truth. Now, remember when we went through all those scenarios on the left side for deductive reasoning? How many ways were there to end up with a truth? Just one. You had to follow the process exactly to get the right result. But if you did, you reached an additional truth. Now let's look at the right side. What happens if you follow the process perfectly? No mistakes. You did everything right. What's the outcome? Either you find a not truth, or the best you can say is you find something that's probable. But wait a minute. I followed the process. Right. But that process can't produce truth. Now, which of these methods do you think people use more often? Well, let's think about it. Let me ask you a question. What temperature does water boil at? 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Good job. I'm sure you meant to add at sea level, right? So let me ask you another question. What temperature does water freeze at? 32 degrees? Good job. Again, I'm sure you meant to say at sea level. Now, how did you know that? Have you personally ran those experiments and collected that data? Did you boil water and freeze water with a thermometer at sea level? Let me ask another question. How much of the Earth's surface is covered with water? 70%. Oh, good job. Have you personally measured that? You circumnavigated the globe in a sailboat and wrote everything down and calculated 70%? You get the point. You relied on revelation to get these truths, not on your direct observation. Now, what's the point of all this? Believe it or not, people use deductive reasoning the vast majority of the time. And deductive reasoning relies on revelation, which is someone else telling you the truth. The only question is, do you trust your source? Let's all take a deep breath. I know we covered a lot of ground there very quickly. I want to try and pull all this together and get back to our original question, which is, what does it mean to think biblically? You can think biblically. The first thing I want to point out is you can think biblically and still use both of these methods. Both of these are okay. You can think biblically and think deductively. You can think biblically and think inductively. You just have to be honest about what each of these methods can produce. Deductive can produce truth. Inductive cannot. Now, what does it mean to think biblically? Is it to think like God thinks? Let's go to the Bible. Isaiah chapter 55, 8 and 9 says this. This is God talking. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. Neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, soar my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God knows everything and is always right. So can we do that? No. So thinking biblically, is it to think like God thinks? No. We can't think like God thinks, but we can do what he does when he thinks. Let me say that again. We can't think like God thinks, but we can do what he does when he thinks. And this next thing that I'm going to share with you, I can't believe I'm doing this. It took me 5 years to come up with this. These three words changed my life. What does it mean to think biblically? It means this. Don't think falsely. That's it. Don't think falsely. Now, you might say, well, I never think falsely. I'm a smart person, and I only think about things the right way. Well, let me give you three examples that we just covered where a lot of people, maybe not you, but a lot of people think falsely. Number one, inductive reasoning or science can prove things absolutely true. Were there some of you who thought that 10 minutes ago? We just walked it through. That's thinking falsely. How about a second one? You can know everything through inductive reasoning or through science. Again, maybe you didn't think that, but a lot of people today do. That's thinking falsely. And number three, you might have thought, well, people think mostly inductively. They want to experience truth themselves. They don't trust anybody. They go find it out themselves. That's not true at all. That's another example of thinking falsely. I want to give an example of our own Ambassadors Forum tagline. For those of you not too familiar with our ministry, our tagline is to make God known as he is. And as we focused on making God known, we found it came down to two things: destroying falsehoods and proclaiming truths. So our vision statement was to equip believers to destroy false arguments and explain God as he is. And you know what we found? We spent most of our time in our apologetics ministry destroying falsehoods. We found we didn't need to do a lot to reveal God. He does a pretty good job of that himself, through his word, through his spirit, through creation, through our own consciences. We found that we were spending most of our time removing falsehoods, myths, and lies. So I asked my good friend Paul Bogle to draw me a picture to illustrate this too. And here's what he came up with. I think of it like this. It's like a giant cement truck backed up to God and dumped concrete all over him, obscuring who he is. And it's our job to remove that concrete with the hammer and chisel of correct biblical interpretation. So let me give you two practical suggestions quickly of what you can do to destroy false arguments. Number one, use self-consistency as a signpost. Now, what do I mean by self-consistent? I mean it doesn't contradict itself. It doesn't say 2 plus 2 is 4and 2 plus 2 is 5. Let me give you an example. You all know about the theory of evolution. Millions of years, slow, gradual process, etc. Okay, well, I took some classes at Harvard during the time that Stephen Jay Gould taught there. He had discovered that the science of evolution didn't work. Now, Gould wasn't a Christian. He wasn't saying that the Bible contradicted evolution. He was saying, hey, guys, science disproves evolution. So like every good scientist, he proposed an alternative hypothesis. He called it punctuated equilibrium. Now, I don't have the time to teach it here. You can go look it up. Stephen Gould, punctuated equilibrium. But basically, he said evolution had to happen very, very quickly, not slowly. So thousands of years, not millions of years. So let's think about this. If evolution had always been millions and millions of years, and Dr. Gould now said thousands of years, do you see how that contradicted itself? His peers were like, Stephen, you got to take that back. And he was like, guys, the science doesn't work. So that's what I mean by self-consistency. When I think about it like this, finding truth can be compared to searching for a path in a dark forest or a dense jungle. It's not always obvious when you've arrived. But you can use self-consistency as a signpost to let you know that you're on the right track. The second thing is to never use things that are vague to judge things that are certain. Let me give you an example of this. Let's say you were an optician, somebody who fixes glasses and works on people's glasses for them. And you had a pair of dirty glasses and you had a pair of clean glasses. How would you use them to fix the other one? You wouldn't put on the dirty glasses to fix the clean glasses. You'd put on the clean glasses to fix the dirty glasses. So that's what I mean. You take things that you know to try and judge and determine things that you're trying to figure out, not the other way around. Now, let me go quickly through four biblical examples. Because when you think biblically, when you're not looking for a contradiction, but you're looking for a resolution, it will cause you to even read the Bible differently. So I'm going to go through these very quickly. First one, Abraham and Isaac. Number one, God told Abraham that he would have descendants through Isaac. Genesis 17:19 says, Sarah, your wife, will give birth to a son for you. You will name him Isaac, and I will confirm my covenant with him and his descendants. But wait a minute. God also told Abraham to kill Isaac before he had produced any offspring. Genesis 22:2. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and offer him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will show you. So is there a contradiction in the Bible? No. It turns out that if you keep reading in the Bible, you'll find the answer. Abraham had faith that God could raise Isaac from the dead and still fulfill his promises. We find this in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 17 through 19. It was by faith that Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice when God was testing him. Abraham, who had received God's promises, was ready to sacrifice his only son Isaac, even though God had told him, Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted. Abraham reasoned that if Isaac died, God was able to raise him from the dead. Let's go through a second example. Is salvation by faith or by works? The Bible says our salvation is by faith alone, no works. Ephesians 2:8 and 9. For it is by grace that you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. But wait a minute. The Bible also says that faith without works is dead, implying that works are needed for salvation. James chapter 2, verse 17. So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. So, is there a contradiction in the Bible? Keep reading. Later on in Ephesians 2:10, the Bible says that the kind of true faith that brings salvation will result in good works. It says this, in Christ Jesus, God made us new people. He saved us so that we would do good works. God had planned in advance for those good works for us. How about a third example? Resurrection from the dead. The Bible says that Jesus' resurrection from the dead proved that he was the Son of God. Romans chapter 1, verse 4. And being raised from the dead, Christ was proved to be the mighty Son of God. Well, wait a minute. Many other people in the Bible were raised from the dead. Jairus' daughter, Lazarus. Matthew 27 talks about a whole bunch of them. Many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Coming out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So does that mean that the Bible is saying they are also the Son of God? Interestingly enough, in the Bible you find the answer. Jesus' resurrection was unique in that it had been prophesied according to the Scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 says that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. Even in Acts chapter 26, Paul says, I teach nothing except what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer and be the first to rise from the dead, and in this way announce God's light to Jews and Gentiles alike. So what sets Christ's resurrection apart? Because it was prophesied. One last one. I've heard that people say, the Bible portrays the God of the Old Testament as a God of wrath, but the God of the New Testament as a God of love. Two different gods, right? Let me read you some verses. You tell me, and listen carefully, you are a God ready to forgive, gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. What testament do you think that's from? The Old Testament. Let me read you some other verses. When the Lord is revealed from heaven in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel, they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction. And behold, I will throw her onto a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her, I will throw into great tribulation unless they repent of their works, and I will strike her children dead. Which testament do you think that one's from? The New Testament. So we see the truth is that both the Old and New Testaments accurately depict God's character as a blend of both his love and his justice. Now, I want to wrap this up by going back to the beginning where I talked about my own corrupted worldview that I was trained in by my own childhood education. I said the answer was replacing that wrong thinking with a biblical worldview. I want to quickly cover three questions every worldview must answer. Number one, where did everything come from? Number two, why does the world seem broken? And number three, how does it get fixed? Everybody asks these questions. They don't need to read the Bible. They don't need to be told these. Everybody thinks these questions on their own. And a biblical worldview answers them like this. Where did everything come from? God created it. Why does the world seem broken? Because sin, rebellion against God, destroys all that is good. And how does it get fixed? God offers us salvation through Jesus Christ if we repent and turn to him. Now, this summary of a biblical worldview might seem too simple for some of you, but I guarantee you, if you answer these three questions with these three truths and start thinking that way, you will be amazed at how much the world starts to make sense. Now, I need to give you a warning. If you start to think biblically, you are going to start to recognize false arguments everywhere. Who here likes Baskin-Robbins? How many flavors does Baskin-Robbins have? 31, right? You can see it in their logo. Once somebody points that out to you, anytime you go by a Baskin-Robbins shop, the first thing you see, 31, and you're like, 31 flavors. It's going to be the same way with thinking biblically. You're going to find false arguments everywhere, at school. You're going to find them in your church. You're going to find them online all over the place. You'll start to see them everywhere, and you won't be able to not see them because you're going to be thinking the right way. Let me end with this example from my life. So, as you can see, I am short and stocky. I'm not built at all like a long-distance runner. Soccer has always been my game. Lots of short-distance sprinting. Well, I recently took up long-distance running with the goal of wanting to run 5 miles. My first time out, I ran as fast as I could, and I made it about a quarter of a mile. After about a week of training, I could only run about a half a mile running as fast as I could before I was just totally gassed. I still wanted to run 5 miles, though. So, and I knew there was no way I could ever do it running at my soccer sprinting speed. So what I did is I slowed way down. And you know what? I actually ran 3 miles the next day. And I was so proud of myself. I'm like, I figured it out. I know how to run long distance. You just have to run way, way slower. But you know what was interesting? I woke up the next day, my hips hurt, my knees hurt, my ankles hurt. I could hardly walk. And I started talking to some runners, and I'm like, what happened? And they said, everybody has their own body mechanics, which give us a specific gait that we are supposed to run at. Now, when I had tried to run slower than I was designed to run, it caused me pain. I learned that my body is supposed to run a 7.5-minute mile. So if I want to run 5 miles, they have to be at a 7.5-minute pace. And you know what? Since then, I've trained and I've gotten to where I can do that. And I can go out and I can run 5 miles and feel fantastic immediately after the next day because I'm running at the speed that God designed me to run at. Now, I have found that it's the same thing when we try to think biblically. Our changed way of thinking that we covered in the beginning of this talk from Romans 12 says that we are supposed to change the way our thinking is, and we're supposed to be all in. No false thinking, no half-truths, no partial worldviews. Here's what it looks like in real life. Many people in the U.S., because of the history and culture of our nation, think at least partially biblically. Now, that's changing, but for the most part, it still holds true. So then they try and think just a wee bit more biblically, and they're miserable. Why? Because when you think biblically, it's supposed to be all in. You can't be halfway and a little bit more than halfway. That's all miserable. If you're going to think biblically, you have to think biblically all in. So what happens? A lot of people just give up and they say, you know what? I can't think biblically because I tried it a little bit and it was terrible. And I tried it a teeny bit more and it wasn't working for me. The problem was you have to go all in. So what's the solution? What am I going to challenge you with? I want to dare you. I want to dare you today. I want to leave you with a personal challenge. I want you to make a commitment today that you're going to try to think biblically the way we've described it, and that you're going to go all in. Don't think falsely. Don't think with a false worldview. look at the world through a biblical worldview and be all in. I guarantee it. If you make that all-in commitment today, the whole world will make a lot more sense. Thank you.